Welcome in this second video on life annuities. In the first video, we considered discrete life annuities with yearly payments. Now we will introduce annuities with continuous payments and then also annuities with monthly payments. Let us start with the continuous case. We consider first a whole life continuous annuity. So we consider an annuity underwritten to X at time zero, and it pays continuously at the rate of one per year as long as X is alive. The cash flow is as follows. There is a payment DT around time T, and we have to sum of all these infinitesimal intervals between time zero and time TX, the moment of death of the insured, or summing the continuous, the infinitesimal intervals is in fact integrating over them. Notice again that this integral of these couples is just a symbolic notation. What is then the present value of this series of payments? There is around time t, in the interval t, t plus dt, there is a payment dt. Discounted value is v to the power t dt. And we have to sum all these payments between time zero and time tx, the moment of death. This random variable, y, if you look at formula 5.2, we can write it, this present value, as a continuous annuity, the present value of a continuous annuity with a duration of tx years. So if we, in formula 5.2, replace the n by tx, we have the atx here. Notice that this is a random variable because the duration of length tx is of course random. And then we also know from formula 5.2 that atx can be written as 1 minus v to the power tx divided by delta. If we want to determine now the actuarial value, we have to take the expectation of y, and the expectation of y is 1 minus expectation of v to the power tx divided by delta. But we have encountered already this expectation. Expectation of v to the power tx was the actuarial value or the expected present value of a continuous whole life annuity ax. And we have a symbol for this actuarial value. We will denote this by ax, overlined. The A stands for the fact that it's an annuity. The X stands for the fact that the payments are due in case the insured of age X at policy issue is alive. And overlining means that the payments are continuous. The annuity pays an amount of 1 per year, continuously spread over the year, so DT per interval T, T plus DT. Okay, so here we have an expression for the actuarial value of an annuity as a function of the actuarial value of a whole life insurance. Now the benefit cash flow can also be written in another way. Here we have deterministic cash flows over a random time interval, but we can also write it as random cash flows forever. So there is a payment at any possible, in any possible time interval tt plus dt, but the payment is random. It's only one, it's only positive in case the insured is still alive at time t. Rewriting this cash flow in this way, and now taking the present value of the right-hand side cash flow, we get that the present value is integral between zero and infinity. A payment of one, if a payment of dt in case the insured is still alive at time t, discounted value is e to the power minus delta t, and we have to integrate between zero and infinity. In order to determine the actuarial value of this cash flow, we have to take the expectation of y, and the expectation of y is then, of course, equal to the integral between zero and infinity, e to the power minus delta t. The expectation of the indicator variable is the probability that x is still alive at time t, and then multiplied by dt. So this is the second expression for the whole life continuous annuity, expressed as an integral of, in fact, actuarial discount factors. Because e to the power minus delta t px t, we called this already before, the actuarial discount factor over the period 0t. Here is a timeline diagram that gives a little bit of more information about how you come to the formula. So in the interval t, t plus dt, there is a payment dt. Dt is the amount that is paid in this interval. The discounted value is e to the power minus delta t dt. And the probability that this will be made, this payment, is pxt. So pxt multiplied by e to the power minus delta t multiplied by dt. This is the discounted value, or better, the actuarial value of the payment in the interval dt plus dt. And then we have to integrate over all time in order to get the whole value, actuarial value, for the continuous annuity. The whole life continuous annuity can also be expressed in another way. That's way three. We know already that the benefit cash flow looks as follows, and that the present value looks like this, and that this present value can be written as the present value of an annuity for a duration of tx years. So this is a function of tx. A overlined x is then the expectation of y. So that's an expectation of a function of tx. And if we write down this expectation, we have pxt mu x plus t dt. That's the probability that the insured lives until time t and then dies. If that happens, then the present value of his payments are at, and we have to integrate over all possible times of that. So we have to integrate between 0 and infinity. Let us now consider a term continuous annuity. So it's an annuity similar as what we have seen before, continuous payments, but only limited payments. The payment period is limited to a maximum of n years. So we consider an annuity underwritten to x at time zero. It pays continuously at the rate of 1 per year for a period of n years, n of course, provided x is alive. In this case, the benefit cash flow is as follows. There is a payment dt around time t, and this interval, so we have to integrate between 0 and the minimum of tx and n. So the payments stop at time n or earlier in case the insured dies before time n. The present value is denoted by y. It's the present value of this cash flow stream, is integral between 0 and minimum of tx and n, e to the power minus delta t dt. Or we can write this as the present value of an annuity continuously paid with the duration of minimum of tx and n years. So the duration is random. And this insurance, this present value, can be written, as we know, as 1 minus v to the power minus tx and n divided by delta. The actuarial value is then obtained by taking the expectation of y. So that's taking the expectation of this part here. So we get 1 minus expectation of v to the power minimum of tx and n divided by delta. And this expectation, we have seen this already. We know that this is the expected present value, or the actuarial value, of an endowment insurance A bar xn. So here we have a first expression for a term continuous annuity. It is expressed in terms of the actuarial value of an endowment insurance. Another expression, second expression for a term continuous annuity, we have our benefit cash flow, which we transform in a cash flow, a random cash flow over a deterministic time period 0n. We take the present value of this cash flow and we find y is integral between 0 and n e to the power minus delta t 1 provided tx exceeds t dt. And then the actuarial value axn bar is in fact the expectation of y, or that's the integral between 0 and n e to the power minus delta t, then the expectation of the indicator variable, but the expectation of the indicator variable is pxt multiplied by dt. And then we can also express the term continuous annuity in a third way. We have here again our benefit cash flow of the continuous term annuity, we have the present value, and the present value, as we have seen, could be written as A overlined for a duration minimum of Tx and n. This is a function of Tx, so let us calculate the expectation of this function of Tx. That's the expectation of y. Well, we have to make a difference between the first dying the first n years and dying after time n. If the insured lives until time t and then dies after time t, then the present value of his payments are at. This is provided t is within the first n years, and we have to integrate over all possible times t in the first n years. But there is a second option. It's possible that the insured is still alive at time n, so he dies after time n, then he will get payments until time n, because at time n, by definition, the payments stop. The present value of these payments are a overlined n. Now that we have introduced continuous annuities, let us now go to monthly annuities. A pension is typically paid per month. So we consider more generally annuities payable 1 over m. Let us take in our mind that m is 12, so monthly. First, recall that the future lifetime of x in years rounded down to the lower 1m of the year was denoted by kxm, or kx12 is in fact the beginning of the month in which you will die. Kxm is the random variable expressing the beginning of the month in which you will die, and this time is described, is expressed in terms of years. A second formula that we have to recall is an annuity due with monthly payments can be expressed as follows. So we have the following cash flow. There is a payment 1 over m at each time k over m, where k goes between 0 and j. So the first payment is at time 0. The last payment is at time j over m. This present value of this cash flow, we had a notation for that. That's an a double dot m for a duration of g plus 1 divided by m years. So that is an annuity. There's a present value of an annuity that pays for g, a period that has g plus 1 payments at the times 0, 1 over m, 2 over m, until g over m. This annuity, this present value, is of course equal to this sum. And this sum can be expressed as 1 minus b to the power j plus 1 over m divided by dm. As we have seen before, we will denote this formula by star because we will need it further in our derivations. Now, let us introduce a whole life annuity payable monthly, the first, and derive the first expression for it. We consider an annuity underwritten to x at time 0. It pays an amount of 1 per year. It's payable in advance, so in the beginning of the period, but m times per year, so 12 times per year, let's say, throughout the lifetime of x. How is the benefit cash flow looking now? There is a payment of 1 over m at any time k over m, where k goes from 0 until m times kxm. The last payment happens at time k over m with k equal to m times kxm. So if k is equal to m times kxm, that means that k over m is kxm. So the last payment is in the beginning of the month of the year of death. This cash flow now, let's take the present value of it. The present value we will denote it by y. It's 1 over m, the same sum of a payment k over m at time, of a payment of 1 over m at time k over m, so discounted v to the power k over m. If you look at the formula star, we can write this as a double dot m for a duration of kxm plus 1 over m years. And we know that this present value can be expressed as 1 minus v to the power kxm plus 1 over m divided by the m. This all comes from formula star that we have just seen before. Now we have the present value. Next step, we want to take the expectation of this present value. So that's the expectation of this random variable. This is 1 minus the expectation of this v to the power k is m plus 1 over m divided by dm. And this expectation, we have a notation for that already. That is in fact the actuarial value of a whole life annuity that pays 1 at the end of the month of death. So this first expression, formula 5.18, expresses the actuarial value of a monthly annuity with payments in the beginning of the month, expresses this actuarial value as a function of a whole life insurance with payments at the end, with payment, that benefit payment at the end of the month of that. We take the same whole life annuity, but derive a second expression for it. We know that AA double dot XM can be written as a sum of expected present values of all future payments. So the payment at the time T over M will be 1 over M. 1 over M will be paid at the time T over M. So the discounted value is multiplied by V to the power T over M. And this payment is only due if the insured is still alive. So multiplied by PX T over M. And we have to sum over all T. Then there is, of course, the following relation between an annuity immediate and an annuity due. This is the annuity immediate. So it starts with the payment 1 over M lifelong, but it starts at time 1 over M. This is also a lifelong payment of 1 over M per mth of the year, but it starts at time 0. So the relation between the A and the A double dot is, the difference is the 1 over M. So we have to subtract from this value 1 over M to get the annuity immediate value. Here is a timeline diagram that expresses for the whole life monthly annuity due how we come to the second formula. Then here an example in the whole life annuity payable monthly. Let's have a look at an example of a life annuity sale. In 1965, at age 90, Jeanne Calment sold her apartment by a life annuity sale, the French Jeanne Calment. At that time, her expected remaining lifetime was about more or less 3 years. The buyer was André-François Raffray, and he was going to receive the apartment at the death of the seller, at the death of Jeanne Calment. So what he will receive is the apartment at, let's say, K9012 plus 1 over 12, so at the end of the month of the death of the seller. In return, the seller, so Jeanne Calment, was going to receive a whole life annuity of 2,500 francs per month. So the cash flow that she was going to receive was 2,500 at time K over 12 for each time, for each K between 0 and 12 times K9012. So the last 2,500 will be paid in the beginning of the month of her death. This was considered as a good deal because her expected remaining lifetime was 3 years, but Jeanne Calment died in 1970, aged 122. So she lived more than 10 times longer than what was actuarially expected. Let us now have a look at term annuities payable monthly. Term annuities are annuities that are only paid during a certain term, for instance, for 10 years. So we consider an annuity underwritten to X at time zero, paying 1 per year, payable in advance, M times per year, throughout the lifetime of X, limited to a maximum of N years. So the cash flow looks as follows. There is a payment of 1 over m at time k over m for k going from 0 until the minimum of m times k x m and m times n minus 1. Let us check where is the last payment. The last payment is at time k over m with k given by this minimum of k x m and n minus 1. So k is the minimum of m times kx m and m times n minus 1 is equivalent to saying that k over m is the minimum of kx m and n minus 1 over m. So that means that the last payment is at time is 1 month before time n, or at the beginning of the month of that, if that happens earlier than time n. Then we have to determine the present value of this cash flow. The present value of this cash flow, have a look at formula star that we have seen before. This present value can be written as an annuity due with payments and payments per year for a duration of minimum of kx plus 1 over m and n years. And this annuity, this present value due to formula star, can be written as 1 minus v to the power something divided by dn. This is the present value. Now we have the present value, we have to calculate the actuarial value, so we have to take the expectation of y. Just as always, the expectation as y is the expectation of this expression. And this can be expressed as 1 minus AXNM divided by DM. So that means our first expression here for the annuity payable, the term annuity payable monthly, it is expressed in terms of an endowment insurance with payment at that in at the end of the month of debt. The same annuity, let us now have a look at another expression for it. We can write, and by now it should be clear that in fact the actuarial value of an n-year term annuity with monthly payments of 1 over 12 is equal to a sum of the actuarial value of all payments. Let's have a look at the payment at time r over m. At time r over m, there will be a payment 1 over m. Discounted value is v to the power r over m. And the probability that you will get this payment is px r over m. We have to sum from r is 0 to n minus m times n minus 1. The max, the last possible payment is at time r over m with r equal to m minus n minus 1. So r is m times n minus 1 is equivalent with r over m is n minus 1 over m. So indeed, the last possible payment is 1 month before time n. Formula 5.22.3 is then a relation between the annuity immediate and the annuity due. The annuity immediate is the annuity due, but there are here in the right-hand side two different payments. There is an additional payment here at time zero, so we have to withdraw that payment. So that's minus 1 over m. Okay, and here we are missing a payment at time n. The payment at time n here, so we have to add here plus v to the power n pxn. And here is again the time diagram for the monthly annuity to check all the possible payments, all the amounts that are paid upon survival, the discounted value of them, and the probability that they are paid out. Now we will compare annuity payments by payment frequency. So we look at an annuity with payment 1 at the end of the year. This is an annuity with payment 1 over the year, or 1 over 4 every 3 months, but at the end of the every 3 months, but at the end of the 3 month period. This is a payment of 1 per year, but continuously spread over the year. This is a payment also of 1 per year, but in the beginning of each 3 month period. And this is a payment of 1 per year, but paid in the beginning of the year. The values that are obtained here, we used the technical basis, the standard ultimate survival model, and an interest of 5%. And what we observe is this ordering between the different annuities. Notice that all these annuities are about a payment of 1 per year, provided the insured is alive. But if we go here, AX, the payment is the last payment, it's just at time 1. While here the payment is immediate at time 0. AX4, Here the payments are a little bit later. They are at the end of each 3 month period. Here the payments are continuous. Here the payments are in the beginning of each 3 month period. And here the payments are in the beginning of the year. So the more you go to the right, the earlier the payments. So that's one of the reasons why this ordering holds. The time value of money. If something is paid later, then the insurance is cheaper. But this is not only the one, this is not the only reason why this ordering holds. There is a second reason. The payments are only due upon survival. What does that mean? This AX, this is in a payment of one that you will receive at the end of the year. So in the year that you will die, you will not receive at the end of that year the one. But in the year that you will die, here you will have received the one in the beginning of the year. So that's the second reason why this ordering holds. The more you go to the right, the more you received of the amount of one that was going to be paid to you upon survival in the year. Okay, so again, there are two reasons for this ordering: the time value of money, the later you get your payments, the cheaper, and also the payments are only due if you survive. So the more you go to the right here, the more you have received of the one from the last year. Okay. Then there is an example, 5.2, in the book, consider it carefully. And then some citation by Samuel Hübner, the person who we met already before. He said the following: annuitants are long livers. Freedom from financial worry and fear and contentment with the double income are conducive to longevity. I am inclined to believe that annuities serve in old age much the same economic purpose that periodic medical examinations do during the working years of life. So what does that mean? Having an annuity, being sure of an income, is maybe something that gives you freedom in the mind and that makes you live longer. That's a statement that he makes. And then he also says, why exist on $600, assuming a 3% interest on $20,000, and then live in fear when $1,600 may be obtained annually at age 65 through an annuity for all of life and minus all the fear? What does he want to say then? So suppose that we have a capital of $20,000. What we can do with this capital is we can live on interest, we can invest it, and suppose that the interest is 3%, then we get $20,000 multiplied by 3% is $600 per year. Or we could use this $20,000 to buy a life annuity. Let us suppose that the price of a yearly life annuity from age 65 on is 12.5. What will then, how much can you buy as a monthly, as a yearly payment for the 20,000? Well, then, as we will see in the following chapter, we have to solve the following equation. You want to have a certain amount, not one per year from age 65 on, but a certain amount. And this certain amount, let's call it for the moment X. X multiplied by A double dot 65 is the present value of all what you will receive. And this present value must be equal to 20,000, because 20,000 is the capital that you have available now. And if you see, if you check, the X must then be 1600. So if you invest 20,000, you buy a life insurance that pays you a lifelong pension in the beginning of every year, there is a possible pension of 1600 per year instead of the 600 here. In fact, this comparison is not 100% fair, because here, if you live on interest, you only have 600 per year, but the moment that you die, there is 20,000 left. While here, you have used the 20,000 to buy the life annuity of 1600, so it's a higher amount per year that you have than pure interest, but at the moment that you die, the 20,000 is gone. There is nothing of a capital left. Then let us introduce another type of annuities, deferred annuities. So far now, we always assumed that the annuities immediately started, means immediate now or at the end of the year. Let us now consider an annuity underwritten to X at time zero with lifelong annual payments of one in the beginning of the year, but it is commencing at age X plus U. U is a non-negative integer. So for instance, I want to buy a pension, but it only has to start the pension at my retirement age somewhere in the future. So we have a look at this graph here. So there is time zero, which is now time one, U minus one, U, and the payment only starts at time U. And from time U on, there are survival benefits lifelong. The benefit cash flow now looks as follows. There is a payment of one at time K, and K goes from U, is the first payment, until time KX is the beginning of the year of that. Suppose that the insured dies before time U, then KX is smaller than U, and by convention, we have said that such a sum of cash flows is just the zero cash flow if KX is smaller than U. What is now the actuarial value? The actuarial value of this cash flow is denoted by A double dot X U bar. So that means it's an annuity paid in the beginning of the year, as long as it is alive, but the first payment is deferred for U years, only starts in U years. And then it's easy to see that this AXU bar can be written as AX dot, so a whole life annuity minus a temporary annuity, a term annuity. Indeed, receiving a pension from time U on is receiving a pension from time one, from time zero on, immediately receiving the pension, but the first few years you have to pay back the pension. So again, receiving a pension from 10 years from now is receiving a pension from now on, but the first 10 years you have to give the pension back. That is essentially the meaning of formula 5.25. Then there is also a relation via actuarial discounting, A double dot X U bar. So an U year deferred annuity can also be written as AXU multiplied by A double dot X plus U, where AXEXU is the actuarial discount factor, as we call it. For formula 5.26, let's have a look at the next slide for an expression, for an intuitive interpretation of. So what is A double dot X U bar? The deferred annuity starts paying from time U on an amount of one, and these are all survival benefits, so they are received upon survival. And the green arrow here means that we are evaluating here at time zero. So this symbol is a notation, is a symbol for the expected present value of this cash flow. But we could also write it, this expected present value, instead of looking at all the paid payments from time U on, we bring them all together. All payments from time U on, if the insured is still alive at H X plus U, their actual value will be A double dot X plus U. So instead of receiving all the future ones lifelong, you could say no, you receive A double dot X plus U, actuarially, that's equivalent. If we are now looking from time zero on, not everybody will receive at time U A double dot X plus U. This is only for the survivors. So that means that this series of cash flows seen from time zero on is actuarially equivalent with receiving A double dot X plus U at time U, provided you're still alive at time. Now, taking the expected present value of this cash flow is very simple. It's a payment of A double dot X plus U, provided you are alive. So this is EXU multiplied by A double dot X plus U. And EXU is, as we always called it, the actuarial discount factor. Here is a timeline diagram that expresses the payments and the discounting and the probabilities related to the payments over time. Then there are some more relations to be considered. A deferred term immediate annuity. Now we have a deferred annuity. It's deferred for U years. It's a term insurance, it's for N years, so there are payments between time U and time U plus N, and it's an immediate annuity, that means that the payments are at the end of the year. Okay, this actual value can be written as an annuity given to someone of age X plus U for N years, so an immediate annuity for N years starting at age X plus U, but this is valuated at age X plus U given that the insured is still alive, so we have to multiply by the actual discount rate. In the same way, we can define, or we can prove expression 5.27. Here we have a deferred annuity due payable monthly. Can be expressed as an annuity due that starts immediately at age X plus U, but then we have to discount actuarially to time zero. We also have a term annuity due, A double dot XN, which can be expressed as a lifelong. So if you receive a pension for at most N years, you receive the pension lifelong, but you have to give back everything that you will receive after time N. That's expression 5.28. Then we have a term annuity due payable monthly, an expression for it. So this is in fact very similar. Formula 5.29 is very similar to formula 5.28. Have a look at it. And then we look at a continuous term annuity here. We have now an annuity that exists for N years and there is a continuous payment of one per year. So there is a payment of one per year, maximum for N years. We can split this as in N deferred one-year term annuities. So here we have this annuity over the whole N years is equal to a U-year deferred annuity with, for a duration of only 1 year, and we sum U over zero until two. We sum U from zero to N minus one to capture all the N years in the first N years that are gone. Then there is another example, 5.3, that you have to have a look at. And then something about deferred annuities in an application is some notes about increasing the retirement age and what is the relation then with deferred annuities. So let us take a technical basis as follows. We assume that mortality follows the standard ultimate survival model and that the interest is 3%. And now assume that there is a pension reform so that the pension age will be increased from age 65 until age 67. So if there is an increase of 2 years before you can retire. What is under the assumptions of the technical basis, the actuarial value at age 65 of a pension of one per year? Suppose that you have a pension of one per year. When the pension starts at age 65, then A double dot 65 is 16.440. When the pension only starts in 2 years from now, then we have a 2 year deferred annuity for a person of age 65. This is 14.4.74 under the technical basis that we just have assumed here. What is now the relative decrease of the pension liability for a person of age 65? So let us express the 2 year deferred annuity as a function of the immediate annuity. Well, the 2 year deferred annuity is only 88% of the immediate annuity. So that means if we increase the pension age from age 65 to 67, then for a person who is now 65, there is a reduction of 12% in the liability. So it's 12% cheaper to fund this liability, let's say. This is not the only gain that the government will make in case you increase the pension age for a 65 years old with 2 years. In addition, this 65 year old person will have to work very likely, will pay social security contributions between age 65 and age 67 too. So there is more than just the 12% as gain. That's the end of the second video on life annuities. Thank you for your attention.